Hello, I'm Theresa and I'm a PhD candidate and researcher at TU Berlin. I'm going to be talking about the future of networking APIs today, which is part of some work that we're doing in the IETF in the TAPS working group right now. And so basically, why do we need a new networking API, right? It is because networking is actually pretty complicated. Let's assume we are the laptop here and it wants to, this laptop wants to connect to the server through a network and it's connected to the Wi-Fi via some local access point. So it resolves a host name for the server and it gets back maybe an IPv4 and an IPv6 address or multiple, and then it just tries to connect to that address, right? And first problem, IPv6 failed for some reason. We don't really know why. All right, now our application hopefully notices that at some point and doesn't come back with, everything failed, but it remembers that there's still IPv4, and so it can connect to the server and basically implement this fallback itself probably, right? And then there could also be a different option to connect to the same server, because maybe our Wi-Fi is actually really shitty. Maybe we are in some, in some cafe and the Wi-Fi hotspot is really congested and we need kind of a better connection to that server. So maybe it would be an option to go through a different interface from the same computer. But how do we really know about it within the operating system or within the application? Right now, the application would have to discover somehow that there is this different interface, and then it would have to use this path, basically pick this path itself, and also monitor whether, like, which of the paths is better. And then there might also be an alternate server over this other path, because we could resolve the same name on different networks, and then maybe we get different answers based on which network we actually resolve the name on. And then, we have to pick which of those remote IP addresses we actually connect to. And then also, maybe we want to speak a different transport protocol, because TCP is nice, but now there's also QUIC. And we don't really know beforehand which one will be available. We could try out both, but again, with the socket API, because the socket API provides a very basic abstraction, our application would have to do all this by itself, or like some library within the networking stack of the operating system, obviously. But the point is that for all these different options, there's just a lot of choice and it's getting more complex. And right now, applications are not always benefiting from all this diversity of different paths, different endpoints, and different transport protocols, and then also like IPv4 versus V6. Is there a fallback? Is it working in a smart way? So the point is, networking is more complex than just opening a single bit pipe to some endpoint that we know. And maybe we can have something better with that. And that is what we are trying to do with this new abstraction for an API. So the new API should hide the complexity of the network, so the application doesn't have to discover the different paths, discover the different endpoints, discover the different transport protocols, set up this socket, then try this other socket if the first one didn't work. But it should just say, I want a connection, and then it should get its connection, and whatever happens underneath should not be the problem of the application. So that is what I mean by hiding the complexity. Then it would be nice to choose the best option. We are not always sure which is the best option. This is something I actually talked about last year here, that is part of the research that I'm doing. But there should be some way within this or beneath this API to optimize these choices. And then also a very important point is that our API should stay stable if new protocols are being developed. So now we have QUIC as a new transport protocol. We don't know. Maybe this is the start of like a new family of transport protocols, or we don't know what protocols are going to be developed in the future. But do we really have to bother the application with this? And does the application have to change if a new protocol is developed? Well, it shouldn't, right? So TAPS is now a proposed abstraction for such an API. So the work I'm presenting is, one, this is work in progress, and some of the details might change. I'm presenting it based on the drafts in the version 0.1, but we are still working on them and like figuring out the details. And then another thing is that this is not one specific implementation, but it's a proposed abstraction for an API. So it is the principles of how such an API should work, and then there is implementations that actually I'm going to talk about at the end. So yeah, something more about how this abstraction should work. Well, if you want to hide whether it's an IPv4 or an IPv6 address, you can just give your application a host name that it wanted to connect to, and maybe some more details like security related to make sure that that all works out. But you don't actually have to give your application an IPv4 or IPv6 address. You can just work based on some remote endpoint identifier, for example, a host name. About paths, well, the application doesn't always have to know which local interface it is using. Of course, maybe the application wants to voice a preference, do not use the cellular ever because it might cost the user money, for example. But if it doesn't say anything, or maybe there's also a default policy, the application doesn't need to be the only one that knows about the paths. And then also, and then about the protocols, well, is there a way to abstract protocols? We have a very basic abstraction in the socket API. There's basically stream protocols and datagram protocols, and stream protocol is right now basically always TCP, datagram is always UDP. So that goes in this direction of just telling us about a generic feature of the transport protocol, but in our opinion, it doesn't go far enough. So the first steps in the Transport Services Working Group TAPS is that we abstracted features of existing transport protocols, for example, reliable data transfer, does the protocol have it or not? Or some more fancy features, for example, multipath, so there's multipath TCP, or for example, for SCTP, the stream control transmission protocol, you can have like different messages and then configure stuff on the different messages, and you have different streams. And so there's features that different transport protocols have that maybe many developers have never heard about, and we don't want them to have to learn all the details of these protocols, but they have to just say, I want this feature on my connection, it needs to be reliable. Or maybe there is this part that needs to be reliable and this other part doesn't need to be reliable because either it arrives and then that's good, or if it doesn't arrive, I don't want to bother resending it. So the application could just ask for abstract features of transport protocols, and then there's a set of transport features that comprises a transport service, which corresponds to like what a transport protocol can offer, but that would not be tied to a specific transport protocol. But okay, that is just some details on terminology. The important point is that the application specifies a transport feature, and the transport system then, based on those requirements, picks a transport protocol. It might be TCP, but it might also be something else that the application developer has never heard about and does not need to hear about. So yeah, that would mean that the application says something like this, something hopefully rather basic. It can also be more complicated, of course. Some applications want to optimize low-level networking details. They can still do that through our API, but maybe it only wants to say these three things. And then the TAPS API gives back not one socket where you can either send or not, but it can give back a connection object. And on this connection, that is going to be a valid connection at some point, a valid transport layer connection to some endpoint. The application can send messages, and then later it's also going to receive messages on it. And it doesn't have to care about the details of the protocols or paths. Right, so a few more details on how this looks like, or what this looks like in our current draft, and you can also read up on the details. I hope that a new version gets published in like a few weeks' time. we have this notion of a pre-connection in the API. An application would set up some kind of like prototype or some kind of thing that it wants a connection to be later on, and that one can be reused. It could specify a remote endpoint that it wants to connect to, for example, based on a host name. It could specify some properties that I'm going to talk about on one of the next slides, and then it can also specify security parameters, for example, some private keys or some crypto algorithms that it wants to use or not. And then, after it has set up this pre-connection object that is basically a template for what the new connection should look like, it would call initiate on the pre-connection and get back this connection. And underneath, within the API, now the API would first start by resolving the name, maybe over all the different interfaces. It would get some information, maybe from its cache, about how what transport protocols it knows are available, what protocols might work over this path, and which ones it wants to try first. And then the transport system does something, and the application will at some point get a callback when the actual connection has been established. And so it only has to call initiate once, and then either it gets the connected event at some point, if any connection could be established at all with the properties that were specified, or maybe it would get a connection error if that was not possible. But here, the optimization doesn't have to happen above the API, but below the API. And now it can send messages, and it can also receive messages on it. Now, to specify an endpoint, it could specify a host name and a service, or also it could also specify an IP address, of course. And then the remote specifier can also be reused for multiple connections, or rather multiple pre-connections, maybe even with different results. And now the transport properties. Transport properties are fun, because those are the transport features that I mentioned earlier. Do I want reliable data transfer? Do I want to configure checksums? You can configure, in UDP Lite, you can configure whether you want the checksum to cover all the package or just part of the package. There's some very like specific features that some transport protocols have. I was also surprised when reading about them. And so if you're interested in those kind of details, you can also find them in the draft. But let's just say the application requires some reliable data transfer. And that is a require. It could also just say I have a preference for this specific kind of feature, or I want to avoid a protocol that has this specific kind of feature, or even prohibit. And then it can also add some more properties to this transport properties object that is then going to be tied to the pre-connection. For example, we have this nice thing called capacity profile, which says, do I want the new connection to be optimized for low latency, or would I like to optimize it for high bandwidth? And based on that, the transport system could do different things, enable some algorithms, or choose a different path, maybe. Or also, maybe this is just background traffic, and I just wanted to run in, we call that scavenger mode, where it just takes all the capacity that it can if nobody else is using it. That would be a different congestion control algorithm. So there's this additional information that the application could add for this new connection, and then also the interface. It could say, please avoid cellular interfaces. But I think if you have a preference either for cellular or Wi-Fi interfaces, oftentimes it's kind of, you actually want to say a different thing. Maybe you want to say, oh, I think cellular is going to cost money, so let's go over the Wi-Fi, because the Wi-Fi is not going to cost money. But is this always the case, right? And will this stay the case in the future at all the time? So we would also introduce some features that can that you can express explicitly what you want or what you don't want. And then you don't have to tell us the actual interface. You can just say, I don't want an interface that might cost the user money. Or maybe I'm OK with picking an interface that costs the user money, or maybe it's just a backup path or something like this. But that is some way more high-level information that the application would give us than if it has to take care of, is there a cellular interface, and can we like ask the user for permission whether we can use it, and That is why we chose this abstraction of properties, and we are like right now figuring out which properties we actually need and how do we actually represent them. But so far we got so far that we know there will be requirements, there will be preferences, and there will also be hints of what to avoid and what to prohibit. And then, as I said, it's also possible to ask for a specific feature of a specific transport protocol. If you pick TCP, then please don't use this option, for example, because some applications really want that. All right, now that we have specified transport properties, let's also just quickly take a look at the security parameters. For example, you can add a pre-shared key, you can add a private key, or you can add some information on crypto algorithms, because we want security to be an integral part of this API. Doesn't mean we always have to bother the application with it again, but it would be nicer if this API just tried to pick a secure transport protocol that could be TLS over TCP by default, even if the application doesn't request that explicitly. And then we would initiate this connection. And now, as I said earlier, the application just calls initiate, and it can then just wait for the callback to happen. And beneath, the transport system will resolve host names, will gather protocol and path candidates, and it sorts those candidates in some order, for example, whether the transport protocol meets these preferred features that the application wanted, or whether it does not meet those features, and then it will sort them in a kind of order in which to try them. So it would start with the first option of a combination of a local interface, a transport protocol, and a specific endpoint. It would try to establish a combination on a connection on that. And then if it doesn't work, maybe after 100 milliseconds or some other timeout, it would try a different protocol. And then at some point, when it has successfully established the connection, it would generate the ready event, and then the application knows the connection is ready. All right, then there's messages that you can send over these connections and receive over these connections. The interesting part here is one that we introduced the concept of framers. TCP doesn't provide framed messages, right? HTTP has to do that. You have to do the framing in HTTP, but if the application just wants to send and receive an HTTP message, maybe the HTTP library would implement the framer. You can just plug into the TAPS API, and then the application that works on top of HTTP can just get an HTTP message and send an HTTP message. So there's this nice concept, and then also messages can have their own properties too. For example, maybe one message has a different priority than the other. We call this niceness, which is the inverse of property, and we also have a lifetime attribute for the messages. And now, of course, a connection might also fail, and you can get a send error, you can get a connection error, you can get a close. All right, now about implementations, which I think is the most interesting part for this crowd. As I said, this is a proposed abstraction for such an API, and now it needs to be implemented. And there is the socket intense prototype, which is part of my research, which I talked about last year at this conference. It's a research prototype. It does not do transport protocol selection, but path selection. And there is the NEAT API. NEAT was a EU project that developed a lot of this transport feature stuff also, and implements, I think, a lot of it. It's also a research prototype, and a famous quote by one of the authors is, well, it's open source, somebody should develop it, but it's not me right now, right? So this code is there, but I'm not sure how much it's going to be, like, how much it's going to advance and like to get closer to the API that we're now actually developing. Oops. And then one other nice implementation, but rather closed, is the Apple network.framework application. They had a talk this year at their developer conference where they introduced it. It was a really nice talk, but you know, I can't look at the code. It would be nice to have more implementations anyway. So maybe, and I would really like that, maybe we would have some implementation of this API that runs on Linux, and yeah, that we can play with, and that might also at some point become one viable choice for an application developed on Linux for its networking. So applications can benefit from all this nice networking stuff without having to do it all by themselves. So that is something that I dream about. But for now, I would just invite you to read our drafts. I linked the 01 versions on the page for this talk in the schedule, but also you can just go to the data tracker and get the most current versions. You can comment on our drafts on the mailing list or on GitHub, where we are collaborating on those drafts, and you can play with the implementations, which are also linked on the page in the schedule, I think at least Neat and Socket Intents. And maybe make your own. I mean, one can dream, right? All right, so just to wrap it up, the Socket API is a very simple abstraction for networking. It's too complex, or it puts a too high burden on the application for dealing with all this complexity. And now the Tabs API could provide a better abstraction for addresses, protocols, paths, so the application doesn't have to deal with the low-level networking details. And it would hopefully stay stable as new protocols are being developed. This Tabs API or this Tabs abstraction for an API is being standardized in the IETF. And we would like more implementations, and we also would like more people to read our drafts. With this, thank you. And are there any questions?
Do you expect that new kernel features will be required?
I'm sorry, what?
Do you expect that new kernel features will be required?
New kernel features? I don't think so, because right now we only provide features that are already implemented in transport protocols today. But I think this can be probably implemented on top of the Socket API, but yeah, I'm not sure, but I don't think so.
Is there any buy-in from vendors at this point, which are the libc developers, Android, Google, Apple, Microsoft, basically, the relevant ones?
I am not currently aware of anybody from Google who is actively developing anything like in this, or from Android. That would be nice, but I tried asking somebody, they didn't reply to me, so I know that Apple is in there, and I know there has been a person from Microsoft, but about Android, I don't know. I don't think there is anybody right now. Okay.
Last question.
Yeah.
I am a bit concerned about having too much freedom in choosing a transport protocol. I fear that having to attempt multiple protocols will cause higher latencies in new connections. Mm-hmm. Has this been discussed? Does it support SRV records in the DNS? What is the plan? Thank you.
Well, and does it support SRV records? Well, an implementation would have to do that. Right now, we don't have anything about it in our drafts, but maybe if you can take a look at our drafts and like write a question on the mailing list, that would be nice. About the other stuff, yeah, of course, it would introduce new latency if you have to try another transport protocol first. But you know, the transport protocols is just one thing that you can try. You can also just try the safe option that you know works, and then you have it. So we would of course not want to introduce additional latency for an application just because we want to try out some weird new features, right?
Is Tabs offering anything server side, or is it only client side?
It's also server side. The example I know used is client side, but it's also possible to have a listener, which is another object than a connection. You can have a pre-connection, and then you can turn this pre-connection into either via initiate, you initiate a connection, or you do listen, and then you have a listener, and then you listen for incoming connections, and you have specified the features on the pre-connection, so the listener also has like these features, but it will probably be implemented a little differently. But yeah, this is supposed to be working both for initiating and listening, and also rendezvous, which is peer-to-peer. We also have a person on the draft who knows a lot about peer-to-peer. It's not me, but yeah.
So thanks a lot, Theresa. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but I guess there will always be the hallway track. So yep. Thanks, and another round of applause, please.